amount of cultural knowledge that we have accumulated and are transmitting and generating, especially in the past several thousand years, is truly vast. We're also seeing access to information in ways that have never before been possible. Connections between incredibly diverse cultural communities, being access to technology, to global decision-making that was never possible in the past. The Templeton World Charity Foundation is funding a research project that we're conducting. The objective is to try to understand, both from a developmental perspective as well as from an evolutionary perspective, the building blocks of culture and cultural learning. To try to understand what the kind of cognitive infrastructure that underlies cultural complexity as well as innovation. Tool innovation, technological innovation, differences between the species and how that develops over time. Ultimately, we want to try to understand why it is that our closest primate relative, the chimpanzee, has roughly the same technological repertoire that they've had for thousands of years, and human children are using iPhones at this point. So this project provides insight into what makes humans unique cognitively, culturally, and socially. Cognitive evolution is the process by which the psychological system underlying learning and communication changes over the course of evolutionary history. The way I study cognitive evolution is really an attempt to understand how intelligent activity has evolved, both within and between species. And between species comparison gives unique insight into how cognitive systems that can be in fact quite different or quite similar are capable of really different endpoints. In our species, cognition has evolved in the context of group living, group interaction. Not just our direct interactions, but our interactions with the products of people. Culture is a suite of knowledge systems, technologies, toolkits that are transmitted both within and between generations. Culture is a moving target. It changes, it increases in complexity. This is in many ways quite different from our closest relatives who don't have bodies of accumulated cultural knowledge stored in books and computers and oral traditions. So although all other primates interact quite extensively with members of their own species, the unique features of human culture are this kind of accumulation of cultural knowledge that we have access to. There are multiple differences that can explain technological complexity between, say, chimpanzees, for example, and humans. One explanation is surely neurological and cognitive. They're similar at their kind of most basic, but there are many other explanations for this. Our drive to learn is unmatched by any other species. We're characteristically curious. We have a tremendous appetite for innovating, developing better ways of doing things. So it's our kind of preoccupation with others and what they know through social learning that can explain this really massive difference in content knowledge. What my studies show is that from birth, young children are working to learn how to become members of whatever community that they are born into. They have a very flexible and powerful toolkit of cultural learning strategies. For example, children learn through observation, by watching others in their environment. They learn through participation, So by kind of following along in the activities of others, they learn through imitation, reproducing the behavior of others around them. Many, many years of careful attention and learning from others around us creates vast repertoires of knowledge. They also learn through instruction. That's a big part of what makes human culture exceptional. It's not just that our children are motivated to learn. We're also motivated to spend a lot of time and energy teaching them. We have cultural transmission systems, such as schools, that are specifically designed to teach children that information. The cultural transmission systems, we have educational systems, literacy, numeracy, information technology, provides ever more complex bodies of knowledge to learn from. So you have really a kind of a perfect system of motivated to learn and motivated to teach. Many other animals have the capacity to learn using some of those learning strategies. So for example, observation. We're certainly not the only animal that learns by observing, but we are the only animal probably that learns through teaching. So a capuchin monkey might be tolerant of another juvenile in their environment watching them use a stone tool to crack nuts, but they're not going to sit there and model the particular orientation that tool should be in for that juvenile. There's a lot of debate about whether other animals imitate. I think they don't imitate the way that human children imitate. We're learning that social learning, cultural learning, is absolutely critical to explaining differences between species in cultural complexity. Culture accumulates over time. The more human brains contribute to a body of knowledge, the more it changes, the more complex it gets. Innovation and cumulative culture are deeply interconnected. So innovation allows you to build upon the insights of previous generations, but also to add to them, to modify them, to meet current demands, to solve critical problems. One of the things that you often see in American culture is that we valorize kind of solitary geniuses. And this, in fact, misrepresents the process of scientific discovery.
iPod. A phone.
The reason we have an iPhone now is that we've been able to accumulate the many, many, many insights in previous generations that have led up to the current technology. If you actually wanted to give full credit for the iPhone, there would be hundreds, thousands of names on that list. Cumulative culture will increasingly be transformed by technology. The internet, I think, has profound consequences for what cumulative culture looks like now and what it will look like in the future. There's been tremendous exchange in language, in cultural technology, in values and belief systems. The speed at which we can process it and apply it to new tasks are changing incredibly rapidly. All cultural technologies transform human cognition. They're the product of human intelligence, and the internet certainly transforms how we interact. There are compromises between depth and breadth. So the internet gives access to enormous breadth of information, but it also means that our firsthand experience with systems of knowledge and even with particular people is more limited. The next 10 years are going to require collective action to solve pressing problems that face all of us. Everything from climate change to pandemics to a sustainable human condition that provides the basic rights, basic standard of living. And we need the very best of all human cultural insights in order to tackle these problems. Figuring out how to create a more democratic and inclusive global culture should be a top priority. This is something that humans have never had to grapple with in the past. And there are growing pains associated with constructing identities at the species level rather than the country level or even the village level. The fact that we've prioritized our own species over other species has led us astray in terms of the health of the planet and preservation of biodiversity. So harnessing the best of our nature in order to inhibit the worst of our nature is critical. The good news is that we're tremendously good at cooperating. Even very young children are motivated to cooperate. They're pro-social. So we harness this really kind of core feature and scale it at a scale that is really unprecedented in human history. I'm absolutely optimistic. What is the alternative to that? Humans are creative enough or resilient enough to develop solutions. Going forward, global culture should ideally represent the dazzling diversity of human culture.